Within your presence, I speak Jesus.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Depression, I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is love.
Yes, it is.
Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows.
Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Oh, oh, oh.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Your presence, I speak Jesus.
Over every enemy, Jesus.
Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Shout Jesus, Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Hallelujah, Lord, we praise you, Lord.
Can't go back to the beginning. Can't control what tomorrow will bring. But I know here in the middle is the place where you promised to be. Not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again? As I walk now through the valley, let your love rise above every fear. Like the sun shaping a shadow, in my weakness your glory appears. You come, will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet?
echoes awaken. The Lord is in this place. The Lord is in this place. With a melody, you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Child of God.
the Father. I am surrounded by songs of deliverance. We've been liberated from our bondage. We're the sons and the daughters. Let us sing our freedom.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
So grateful for you. Just thank you for being here with us, Lord, and filling us with your presence and your spirit. Be with us as we continue our time of worship. Fill Pastor with your spirit and your word for us, Lord. We thank you so much for who you are and what you're about to do. Amen.
Yes, Mother's Day. What a blessed day. Happy Mother's Day to all you moms, moms-to-be, grandmas, great-grandmas. We're going to be great-grandparents here in about 2 months, so kind of exciting. Church, I don't know what God has for you this morning. I've been before the Lord since about 10 o'clock last night. Normally, I come in on Sunday. I've got my little manicured messages and scripts and everything, and I've got little slogans for you to put into your minds and hearts to help you throughout the week and stuff like that. And that's all good. It's kind of the way people process things today. People are very visual. People need to be entertained. They like the flash and the lights and the stuff like that. I watched a movie last night. Second time I've watched a movie in like, I watched one last month and I watched this one last night. I don't never watch movies. They normally watch me. But I was challenged in this movie. If you haven't seen this movie, some of you probably have, but I hadn't seen it. I actually wasn't going to watch it because actually I just think that Christians make cheesy stuff. We just do. The reason the world is so successful is because the world, they just know how to put things together. Christians, we're cheese balls. But I watched this movie called Jesus Revolution. And like I said, I wasn't going to watch it because I was afraid it was going to be this cheese ball thing and blah, 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 and oh, you know, but it was nothing but that. This movie challenged me. It had me asking, why do we come here on Sunday? Why are you here today? Why? Why did you get up this morning? And why did you come to this building for this moment? Why are you here? Why am I here? I asked myself, why am I pastoring? Why am I here? What am I doing? What are you doing? And I was struck by several things in this movie. The first thing that I was struck by was the fact that Chuck Smith at this point in time was a very jaded person. I'll tell you why. The movie opens, it shows everybody going to Pirate's Cove to be baptized, and there's hundreds, maybe 1,000 people that are being baptized in Pirate's Cove. And this is during the Jesus movement from like 1968, 69 to about 72, somewhere in there. And then it shoots to a part where there's a young Greg Laurie and the situation with him and his mom. And then it shows Chuck and Kay sitting in front of a television set watching the evening news. And it's talking about the hippies in San Francisco and that San Francisco was the hippie capital of the world. And they were very jaded about it. What's wrong with these people? Look at how they're acting. What's going on with them? His daughter is getting ready to leave. And Kay looks at her and says, honey, are you doing drugs? And she says, no, I'm not doing drugs. And she hears them conversing about what they're seeing on TV. And she basically says, you know, you guys are so glued to this. You watch this every night. What's going on? She says, they want basically the same thing that we do, right? Peace and love is what they're talking about. Isn't that what we're about? Chuck says, well, they need to take a bath, right? Very cynical. She says, you are judging them and you don't even know them. And he says, if God brings me a hippie, I'm going to ask some questions. Well, be careful what you ask. She's driving along one day down the road and she sees this dude walking, Lonnie Frisbee. Some of you probably recognize that name. Lonnie Frisbee's walking, and she pulls over, picks him up. First thing he asks her is, do you know the way, the truth, and the life? And she's like, whoa. Next day, Chuck gets up, walks out, get a cup of coffee. There's Lonnie Frisbee standing in his living room there, all hippied out. Who are you? What are you doing here? Rawr, starts freaking out. Where's my daughter? You know, and she comes running out. She goes, Dad. You said, God sent you a hippie. You'd ask some questions. He says, I didn't mean that literally. Yikes. So he says, hey, can I talk to you for a second? And he walks him over the door and he pushes him out the door. Closes the door. And she's like, if you would just give him 10 minutes. So she brings him back in and they sit down. And Chuck starts talking with him. He asks Lonnie Frisbee, what is it about your people? What is it about your people? And Lonnie says, my people. My people. He says, my people, they're a generation, man, that's seeking truth. They want to know what the truth is. And so they're seeking it right now. They want to know what is real, what is real, what is truth. He says, we tried to find it in the acid. I don't know if any of you have dropped acid before. It's trippy. Tried to find it in the acid, but we couldn't find it in the acid. We couldn't find it in all these things. And suddenly, the truth about who Jesus is dropped into the spirit and soul of this man and is dropped into all these people that are seeking God and not even knowing it. He said, we were desperate. We were desperate. And he says, Chuck, how desperate will you become to reach my people? And he was stuck. He says, we can't walk in to your church. We can't walk through your doors because we're not welcome. We're not welcome. How many of us this morning have the same attitude about people outside of the church today? Transgender, same-sex marriages, and everything else. They're desperate. They're looking for truth. We have the truth, church. We have Jesus. Every one of us were messed up before we had Jesus. I remember my generation coming up. I remember what they said about us. And what we've said about our kids' generation and our grandkids' generation, we talk about it like our generation was so great. We were garbage. Kay said something interesting. She said, the truth is always quiet, but the lies are always the loudest. And isn't that what's happening today? The lies are loud. They're loud on social media. They're loud on the TV. They're loud in whatever it is, they're loud. But the truth is quiet. Because the truth is consistent. The truth is always going to be the truth. It's always going to keep going. So after this movie, I was just like, I'm stuck like Chuck, man. I was stuck. There were so many similarities of my life and his in the sense of how jaded I've become on some things. Pat and I cracked up. We looked at the church when they had a church service. It's like ours, a bunch of empty seats and everything else, chosen, frozen, whatever you want to call it, man. There's no life here, church. We're not alive. I think we go through the motions here at the Refuge. We show up and we go through the motions. We act like Christianese. We talk Christianese. We act like we love each other. And then we leave. And then we come on Wednesday and we act like we love each other again. And we talk about everything at the table except for Jesus. And then we have Pastor come up and he's going to go over his little notes and stuff from his, you know, scripted out message and everything. And then we leave. That's the community of the Refuge? These people were so in love with Christ and so in love with each other, they could not get enough of each other because they wanted to be together. And I realized something. As I'm watching this movie, I'm realizing something. The essence of what was keeping them together was genuine love. It was love. It wasn't motivated by anything else. It was motivated by a love for God because God had done what nobody else could do. He had gotten them off of drugs. He had gotten them out of darkness. He had done something that they tried to do through so many other sources, and it did not happen. But Jesus comes into their life, and bam, they're instantly changed. I said, Lord, what am I doing? What am I doing? As a pastor, what am I doing? Am I coming and playing church with God's people? Are you coming and playing church with me? Because in some ways, I think I am. And so I have a Bible that I keep out on my workbench. It's an old New King James Version Bible. It's old as dirt. But there's something about picking up a Bible and reading it. The tablets, it's great. You got everything at your resources. I personally don't like working off of it, but it's easier for me for my notes and everything else. So I went and got the Bible. I told Pat, hey, you go to bed. I'm going outside on the patio. I'm going out on our deck, and I'm going to chill. And I started looking for the times that Jesus in the Bible talked about love. How many times did Jesus talk about love? One time. Every other time Jesus was talking about the law and the prophets and the fulfillment of the law and things that were to come and all these other types. Only one time does Jesus talk about love. He talks about it with his disciples. The ones that he was going to entrust with the keys to the kingdom. The ones that he was going to send out to begin something that was going to be so radical that it was going to change the world. If you go to John chapter 15. Yep, get your Bibles out because we don't have it on the screen, I don't think. I did give Sarah a warning that it might go there, but if you go to verse 9, it says this, I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. Jesus says, I have loved you as the Father has loved me. He says, remain in my love. Think about that. Jesus' love for these men and these women that were part of his circle was the same love that God had bestowed upon him. He says, remain in this love. We don't remain in this type of love, church. We don't remain in it. We have moments that we're in it, but we don't remain in this love. We don't remain in this love. Jesus says you need to stay in this love. How do you stay in this love? I'm going to tell you how right now. When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love. Just as I obey my Father's commandments and remain in his love. So what is Jesus saying there? Our actions are going to demonstrate the love we have for Jesus and God. Our actions, not what I say. It's what I do. It's what I do. See, that's why in the church today, we've got this faith thing all messed up. We don't even understand what faith is. First off, we misuse the word, and I'm not going to get into it today. But we misuse what faith really is. It's not some blind abstract, oh, I'm just going to walk like, that's not even close to what it is. But we demonstrate the love we have for God by what we do. What we do. How I talk to you. How you talk to me. Am I critical of you? Are you critical of me? Am I always complaining about you? And are you always complaining about me? See, that doesn't reflect the love of the Father in our lives. Jesus says, as I obey my Father's commandments and remain in his love, we are to do the same thing. He says, I've told you these things so that you might be filled with joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. Do you understand that? Listen, you want to have joy in your life? Then do what God wants you to do. Stop acting like you act. Right? If we obey God, if we do what God asks us to do, then we will have joy. If you have no joy, it's because you're not doing what God says to do here. He says, look, follow me. Follow my example. He says in verse 12, and this is so key, this is my commandment. Now, this is not an option. It's a command. It's as if you were in the army and the general said, go over that hill. You got to go. You may not want to, but you do it because you're obeying the authority. He says, love each other in the same way I've loved you. Church, are we loving each other like that, man? Because that's how we need to love. We need to love each other in that mindset, the same mindset that Jesus had. He says in 13, there's no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. He says, you are my friends if you do what I command. So we show our friendship with God by doing what he asks us to do. See, wouldn't it be great to get into heaven and hear Jesus say, you're my friend? You're my friend. Like, when you're somebody's friend, that's special, man. There's something cool about that. There's something special about that. To be friends, there's a kindred spirit. There's something that brings you together with that other person, and you have this amazing friendship. Jesus says, man, you're my friends if you do what I ask you to do. He says, I no longer call you slaves because a master doesn't confide in his slaves. Now you are my friends since I've told you everything the Father told me. You did not choose me. I chose you. Jesus chose you. You had a choice to respond to his calling. I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit. Church, we produce lasting fruit by doing what God wants us to do. Is the fruit on your tree today lasting or is it rotting? I had to ask myself these questions. This is my battle. This is where I've been at since 10 o'clock last night. I could not sleep. I could not. I was in my office this morning because I'm like, God, what do I do? I don't even know what to say this morning to your sheep. These are your people, man. What do I say? Verse 17 says, this is my command to love each other. Love. Love is the ingredient, church. Love is the ingredient today. Love is what we need to have in our hearts. Because that's the love that's going to be the essence of what captures people's hearts and wants them to be in a relationship with Jesus. This is what it comes down to. The same writer, John, he penned something in 1 John, which was where I was going to be at today, in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. I want you to hear the difference of something he's saying here. He says, do not love the world nor the things in the world. He says, if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Now, Jesus is talking about, in John 15, having that same love inside of us that he had for them. And that the love that the Father had for Jesus, that same love is in Jesus and he wants that in us. So we're to love the things of the Lord, not the things of the world. John 17 times uses the phrase the world in his text in 1 John. And what you need to understand is that when he says that, he doesn't mean that we shouldn't love people in the world. We should. We should even love our enemies. It doesn't even mean that we should enjoy the gifts that God, that we shouldn't enjoy the gifts that God has given us, because even John writes that every good gift comes from God. Doesn't mean we shouldn't love creation. We should love creation. Why? Because it speaks to the glory of who God is. What John is talking about here is a mindset that says, I can live without God in this area of my life. What area of your life this morning is separated from God? What area of your life this morning are you saying, you know, God, you can't have that this morning. You can't have that any day of the week, man. That's for me. Because like I told you last week, that's idolatry. Anything that you place above God is idolatry. And the problem today, church, is that everyone has a desired life more defined by ease than struggle. The thing that blew me away the most as I was watching this interaction, it's kind of funny because I knew the story. I mean, if you're a Calvary Chapel person, you've heard this story a million times. But when you see it in action, it's just different. And to see the community that these people had, it was amazing. They lived together. I mean, they were Chuck rented them a house or I don't know what it was and stuck them out there and said, hey, you know, do what you do. But the love and community that they had for each other was amazing. I thought, man, Lord, what would that be like? And then I was reminded that we actually experienced that. Pat and I did. Rick and Lynette did. Tom King and Charmaine did. Back when we were young Christians. You know, we've been walking with Jesus for 32 years. Pat and I came to the Lord at the same time. February 17th, 1991, at 11:48 in the morning. I know exactly what time it was because I saw the clock on the wall. We gave our lives to Jesus. And it's been nonstop for 32 years. There's something to be said when you're young and dumb in the Lord. When as we grow and mature, we get some knowledge and we seem to think we know all these things and all that kind of stuff. And I've realized over the last couple of years, I know very little. I know very little. But I do know what community looks like. And it used to happen every Sunday afternoon at my house. We were the hub. Remember that? We'd have 25 or 30 people after church at our house, man. Three or four guitars out, singing all day long, barbecuing up, just being fools. Nobody wanted to go home. 8, 9 o'clock at night, man, people are still there. And we're still sitting around in a circle in the living room singing songs and people out in the back. It was amazing. We experienced that community. And it's sad because a lot of you haven't. And it's the most amazing thing you can imagine. Community starts here when we come on Sundays. This is where it starts. There are no lone rangers in the body of Christ. If you're trying to be a lone ranger, it does not work. It doesn't. There's no accountability. It's very easy to get off track. It's very easy to get off into doctrine that's not scriptural. It's very easy to fall. And when you fall, you have nobody to help you get up. That's why Jesus sent the disciples out in twos. I know a lot of you this morning have probably tuned me out because I haven't put anything on the screens. And the old pastor's boo-hooing or whatever he's doing. I'm just being real with you today. And I'm being honest with you. People are searching for Jesus. I believe this generation of young people today is no different than any other generation. They are hungry for the truth. They're hungry for the truth. But all they see in the church today is what they see everywhere else. There's nothing in the church. Like if you took my lifestyle and put my lifestyle up against a non-Christian's lifestyle, could you tell the difference? You couldn't. I live just like anybody else does, and so do you. There's no defining factor there, church. There's nothing there that's. I bet none of your neighbors know you love Jesus. I bet you they don't know. Either one, because you have not engaged him, or two, you look just like him. They think you're the same guy or gal that they are. They get in their car every morning and drive off. Go to work, they come home, get in the house, they eat their dinner, put on the boob tube, and that's all they do. Oops, that was a bad word. We used to call it the boob tube someday, so it wasn't like, sorry. Those of you guys, that's what we used to call it back in the day. I don't know. It wasn't referring to like, you know, like a website or something like that. Sorry. But I'll probably get yelled at for that one. I'm sure of that. Huh?
You're making it worse.
Yeah. So, yeah. Anyways. Right?
We love you, brother.
Yeah. What I want to leave you with this morning is how much God loves you. And how that needs to be the most important thing in your life. How much God loves you. How much God sacrificed for you. Because he wanted you desperately. See, God, Lonnie asked Chuck, how desperate will you become to come and get my people? God was desperate enough that he sent Jesus. That's how desperate God was for you and I. He sent Jesus to die on the cross for your sins and for my sins, so that we could for once and for all be reconciled to God by simply believing in the work of the cross, believing in what Jesus has done for us. See, when you're young, you think you're never going to die. And then when you get old, you realize you're going to die because you're getting up in the age where I'm going to be out of here. And suddenly you think about life differently. But I will tell you this, young people still want to know the truth. So what do we do, church? How do we reach this generation today who is really dying to know the truth? We reach them with love. We reach them with grace. We reach them with mercy. And we reach them with truth. We tell them the truth. I'll tell you, when that brother that's sitting here this morning told me about his encounter on Easter, when this young lady had never heard of the story of Jesus, that tells you right there how many people don't know the story of Jesus. And church, as I tell you every week, that's our job. Our job is to talk about Jesus. And so I want to encourage you today, moms, continue to be the example that you are. Continue to be the example to your kids and your grandkids. And help them to lean into Jesus. Help them to lean into Jesus. Moms, you're special. My mom's been gone for 34 years, and I thought about her again this morning, you know. I was very fortunate to be adopted. My years, when I was about 11 years old, they got weird. But my first 10 or 11 years as a kid, man, I had the best parents and the best family in the world. But stuff happens in families. And then everything got weird. My mom, it's because of her that I've got Jesus. Because even though she didn't go to church, she sent me on that darn church bus every Sunday, singing church songs with people. And I got the word into my heart, and it got in there deep. And for many years, I didn't realize it was there. But listen, any seed that you plant into the hearts of your kids, it's going to grow. It will grow. Do not grow weary in doing good, church. Moms, do not grow weary in doing good, because in the end, God will reap what you have sown. And as you sow into your children and into your grandchildren, God is going to reap a harvest, but you must believe that God can do it. Today is the day of salvation and the day of change. Church, what needs to happen for things to change here at the Refuge? Will we be another church in a year whose doors have closed because of we don't grow, because we don't, because we're comfortable here? We know the routine, right? The worship team knows they're going to come in, do their warm-up, sound's going to do their little thing, media's going to do their little thing, and blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, we're going to do whatever we do. Then we're going to come out, and we're going to sing four songs, not five, not three. We're going to sing four, because that's how many we get with multitracks every week. So we're going to sing four songs, and it's not going to be any more than about 25 minutes. Then pastor's going to come out. He might go 30, he might go 45, but we know that he's rarely does he go an hour, and then I can go home and do what I want to do. That is not our existence, man. That's not our existence. This command I leave with you, to love one another. Listen to the words of Jesus this morning. Father, we thank you for your love that did what no one else could do, Lord, and just in your grace and mercy, Lord, you reached down and you pulled us out of what we were in. You washed us clean. You gave us white robes. And you said, that one's mine. And so, Lord, if you've done all that for us, how much more should we be doing here with our brothers and sisters and with those who are lost and searching and seeking God? I ask, Holy Spirit, that you would revive our hearts, you would refresh us, that you would strengthen us, that you would guide us and help us. Oh Lord, that we could just stop judging. Lord, that we could just look with your eyes at others, with your heart at others. That our words would be your words to others, God. I ask, Lord, that you would go before us this day, that you would bless moms to be. Thank you for our moms. Thank you for being the best father ever. We love you. In Jesus' name. Amen.